Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath school lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is for the first 3 months of 2016, January, February, and March. And it's a very interesting one, at least I think so, a series on the Great Controversy. The title of this series is Rebellion and Redemption. And this particular lesson is number 4 in that series on conflict and crisis, the Judges. So you could guess we'll be mainly focusing on the book of Judges and maybe a little on the book of Joshua. But that's the time period we're going to be talking about. So I hope you've got your Bible handy. You might need to check on some of the things we have to say. But before we begin, let's ask the Holy Spirit to guide us. Our wonderful Father, as we open Your word, Your holy word, to consider the lives of some of these ancient peoples and recognize their foibles, their problems, their mistakes. What can we learn from them? Help us to realize that despite all of that, You are working with them. You're willing to work with us as well. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, in the book of Judges, we see repeated cycles. And what's the cycle? What happens in these cycles? The Israelites are attracted by the pagan gods, mainly fertility gods around them. They begin to worship the Baals and the Astartes, and maybe some of the other Canaanite gods. This leads them to what we sometimes describe as God's wrath. We'll talk about that in a moment. And God does what?
Lets them go.
He hands them over. He lets them go into, he says, if you want those gods, help yourself. See what they can do for you. And what happens? They end up as slaves for some oppressive nation. After a considerable period of time, they say, you know what? I think we made a mistake here. Let's try to straighten things out. And they turn back to the Lord. And what happens then? He helps them overcome their enemies and brings peace back to the land. And that peace usually continues for the life of the whoever it was that was the leader that led them out of the difficulty. And then when that person dies, what happens?
Repeats again.
They run off the rails.
Deja vu, right? Well, these judges, what did they actually do? Why are they called judges?
Well, that was part of their function.
Okay.
They mediated between people.
Okay. Mostly civil kinds of suits. There was no criminal system in those days. So this judge would be saying, you know, two people bring a suit, well, what about this piece of land or whatever? Does it belong to him or me or whatever? And these people would be the ones who basically took the place of Moses trying to settle these disputes. But in Judges 2 and 3, there's one of the most incredible descriptions, repeated descriptions of God's wrath in the entire Bible. We won't have time to spend a lot of time with that, but we might look at it just very briefly. If you're interested in this, more on this and about God's wrath, there will be a handout on our website, Theox, that's T-H-E-O-X dot O-R-G, T-H-E-O-X dot O-R-G, entitled God's Wrath as Described in Judges.
Will it be accompanying these Sabbath school lessons, or I know that material is elsewhere on the website, but you're going to put it right alongside.
Judges is a book full of violence, immorality, backsliding, promises made to God that were later broken, and idolatry. It makes the children of Israel look very bad. If your church had passed through a set of circumstances like this, would you record it permanently and publish it for the world to read?
Nope.
Nope. I think that's probably the right answer.
Egyptians didn't. When you read all the hieroglyphs, all that ever they ever did was good.
Mm-hmm. They only
never lost any battles.
Even if the stories are all correct, they really happened. Would you report it? Well, Judges begins with God becoming very exasperated with Israel and even apparently becoming angry. Is this a correct representation of God? I would like you to look at some of these passages and tell. We're going to look at just two or three of them really quickly. Way back in Deuteronomy 31, Moses reports God saying this. The Lord said to Moses, "You will soon die, and after your death, the people will become unfaithful to me and break the covenant that I made with them. They will abandon me." So what's the first step?
People will abandon.
They will leave God and worship the pagan gods of the land they are about to enter. When that happens, I will become angry with them. What's that word there?
Wrath.
Wrath or anger. I will abandon them and they will be destroyed. Does God, when he becomes angry, get upset and lose his emotions and try to strangle some people? What does he do?
He gives them up.
He gives them up, Romans 1.
Why such a poor word there for wrath? Wrath usually intimates that you've gotten upset, you've lost your patience, and you're going to vent all of this in a negative, emotional, punishing way. So why didn't the interpreters of the Bible do a better job of giving us the right word here?
Well, do you think God maybe wanted them to take it very seriously?
Well,
if you say God's angry.
I don't know of a better word, but I would think it just seems like we misinterpret really what's happening here so readily because of that word.
You have to use the rest of the Bible to interpret the words of the Bible. And in many other places that Ken's going to mention and the handout will mention, it'll define what God's wrath is, giving the people up. Letting them go.
Even further back in Leviticus 26, verse 14, and then verses 40 to 45, the Lord said, "If you will not obey my commands, you will be punished." Now, that sounds like God is going to really lay it out on them, isn't he? But if you drop down to verse 44, "But even then, after they've done all these awful things, when they are still in the land of their enemies, I will not completely abandon or destroy them." So what's going to happen when God gets angry? Numbers 32, verses 13 to 15. The Lord was angry with the people and made them wander in the wilderness for 40 years until that whole generation that had displeased him was dead. He will once again abandon all these people in the wilderness, and you will be responsible for their destruction. So, I mean, how many times do we need to repeat this? Deuteronomy 32, 15 to 30. They abandoned God their creator, made him angry, and what does he say? I will no longer help them. In my anger, my anger will flame up like fire. I would have destroyed them completely so that no one would remember them. But then what? Joshua 7, 1 to 12. The Lord was furious. So he says, I won't stay with you anymore. I'll let you go. Judges 2 now, coming to our book of Judges. We read, then the people of Israel sinned against the Lord and began to serve the Baals. They stopped worshiping the Lord. They bowed down, dropping down, they bowed down to them and made the Lord angry. And so the Lord became furious. You wanted a different word? There you go. Furious.
So what's the difference between a parent punishing their child, actively punishing them by whipping them, or by punishing them by abandoning them?
Kind of followed that verse 14 there. That kind of explains just what the question you had. And so the Lord became furious with Israel and let raiders attack them and rob them. He let enemies all around overpower them. God doesn't have to do anything overt. He just stopped protecting them.
How does that alter the emotional intent? We're headed with this explanation of this wrath thing is that, well, God isn't being mean and naughty and nasty to his people. But what's the difference whether he whips them or whether he abandons them and lets somebody else come in and do it?
The difference is what you think about him. That's what we're talking about.
Well, I'm
the
not
great
sure.
controversy is all about.
I'm not sure I think.
Any better of
it? I would think any better.
Hosea 11 follows similar to what we just read here. He says, but how can I do that? I'm God. I'm not man. I can't carry it out. But Let the Babylon come in?
These people aren't the equivalent of two-year-olds being abandoned by God. They're the equivalent of 21, 25-year-olds being, quote, abandoned by their parents, since they insist on going their own way.
Again, if we go to Judges 10, verses 6 to 12, I'll just pick out verses 6 and 7 especially. They abandoned the Lord and stopped worshiping him, so the Lord became angry with the Israelites and let the Philistines and the Ammonites conquer them.
That's God's love. Mm-hmm. God's love. You make a choice. Ultimately, God will honor your choice.
Yeah. The Bible repeatedly, we've already looked at a bunch of places, but we could go on to Romans 1 and so forth. The Bible repeatedly described God's anger as his turning away in loving disappointment from those who don't want him anyway, thus leaving them to the inevitable and awful consequences of their own rebellious choices. Now, those are words repeated numerous times by one of our favorite teachers, A. Graham Maxwell, some years ago.
Well, if they're going to go their own way, then basically they are saying, you know, we don't want you around.
Yeah.
They have exercised choice.
And he is not going to impose his presence on them if they don't want him around.
That's right.
And then the consequences are going to happen. The Philistines are going to come in and get them because he isn't there to protect them.
The single verse that sort of says this the most clearly probably is Hosea 4, verse 17. The people of Israel are under the spell of idols. Let them go their own way. The people of Israel are under the spell of idols. Let them go their own way. God doesn't say, I'm angry at them. He just says, well, there's nothing more I can do. Let them go. Yeah. Well, one of the famous places in the Bible where it really spells this out in considerable detail is in Romans 1. Maybe I should go ahead and just look at that really quick. Romans 1, 18 to 28. I'm going to pick out the key parts. For the wrath of God. Now, Paul says, I'm going to talk to you about Christianity, about what's really important in Christianity. I want to talk to you about the good news, Romans 1, 16 and 17. And the very first thing he talks about is the wrath of God. I mean, would you pick that out as the first thing to talk about in the good news? Well, this is what he says. The wrath of God is revealed from heaven, verse 18. And what happens when the wrath of God is revealed from heaven? Verse 24, therefore God gave them up. In the lusts of their hearts to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies among themselves. 26, for this reason God gave them up to dishonorable passions. Verse 28, and since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to base mind and to improper conduct.
Did God have a choice?
Probably not. Not if he's going to respect their freedom.
Yeah. So, you know, when we read that, it's easy to read in, well, God is just abandoning them. Mm-hmm. But in reality,
They left.
He had no choice but to give them up.
Right. And if we go back and read the words that Jim was referring to.
If God is going to respect mm-hmm. our freedom, yeah. he has to let them go yeah. if they insist.
And that's part of the rules of this cosmic great controversy game that's going on here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Game is a very loose term, but
that's
the rules. If you want to go and ally yourself with Satan, you know, you may do that if you choose to do that.
We say God is all-powerful, omnipotent, omnipresent, omniscient. God is love. And ultimately, all God can do is let evil run its course. Because mm-hmm. if he were to do anything else, he'd be manipulate. He'd be stacking the deck. He'd be doing all kinds of things. And the onlookers would say, hey, there's a foul going on.
Well, let me read those verses. This is the Good News Bible. Hosea 11, verses 8 and 9. How does God feel when he has to let them go? How can I give you up, Israel? How can I abandon you? Could I ever destroy you as I did Adma or treat you as I did Zeboim? Adma and Zeboim, if you look back in Genesis, were two small towns that were destroyed along with Sodom and Gomorrah. My heart will not let me do it. My love for you is too strong. I will not punish you in my anger. I will not destroy Israel again. For I am God and not a human being. I, the Holy One, am with you. I will not come to you in anger.
So God certainly loved the people in Admon Zeboim. So how is it that he, with Israel, he has to let them go, but the people in Admon Zeboim,
he let them go.
I like the way the RSV says, my heart recoils within me. My compassion grows warm and tender. And it's the color.
Well, let's look at these stories briefly. The story of Deborah and Barak. And, well, let me just remind one more time. Let me say, God's wrath, as presented it all through Scripture, or sometimes described as his anger, sometimes described as his fury, is simply his turning away and loving disappointment from those who do not want him anyway. They're running as fast as they can in the other way, other direction. They're choosing Satan as their master, thus leaving them to the inevitable and awful consequences of their own rebellious choices.
And respecting their wishes.
Respecting their wishes. Well, when the Hebrews arrived in Canaan and marched up into the center of the territory, what happened? Do you know? The king of Hazor, Hazor, I don't know how you pronounce that, but I think the Hebrews pronounce it Hazor. Jabin, the king of Hazor, tried to organize a large number of kings from the northern part of Canaan to attack and destroy the Israelites when the Israelites first entered Palestine. Many years later, another Jabin, the new king of Hazor, appointed Sisera, his army chief, to attack and destroy the Israelites living near him. Deborah, designated as a prophetess and judge, whose main job had been to settle civil disputes between opposite parties, received a message from God to appoint Barak to meet the challenge from Sisera. And how did Barak respond?
I'm not going to do it unless you go with me.
Not going to do it unless you go with me.
Unless you as a woman go with me.
Mm-hmm. Taking somebody else's wife along with him, huh? Well, who won in that battle? Well, God won, didn't he? How many times in the Bible did God do the fighting instead of having the children of Israel do it? Can you think of some examples?
Well,
Jericho.
Even back before Jericho, what happened when they fought the Amalekites? They could only win when Moses' hands were up, right?
How about the Egyptian army coming at them at the Red Sea?
Exactly. And Ai, you know, on and on.
How about Gideon?
Yeah, we're going to get to Gideon a little bit.
Lots of others.
So why did they want to fight the battles themselves instead of letting God do it always? Doesn't that seem like a fair question?
Mm-hmm.
Because if you let God do all the fighting, win all the battles, guess who gets the credit? We want to stick swords in people ourselves. We want to be the victorious ones. Now, we know God can do it. Can we do it? It seems like they only turn to God and let God do the fighting when it looked to them like their situation was totally hopeless. And then they say, oh, God, please help us. And God would step in. Well, Deborah was not the only female heroine in this story. Who else was a female heroine? There was a gentleman by the name of Heber, was a descendant of Jethro and his son Hobab, the Kenite. Who was Jethro?
That was Moses' father-in-law.
Moses' father-in-law. So these are relatives of Moses. His wife, Jael, who lived not far from Hazor, welcomed the escaping general Sisera into her home and promised to hide him from the pursuing Israelites. While he was sleeping, she got a large hammer and drove a tent peg through his temples and into the ground.
Real sweetheart, wasn't she?
He's a real sweetheart.
Must have been a pretty deep sleeper.
Had she had practice doing that?
I don't know. That ended the domination of the Canaanites over the Hebrews for about 40 years. You think that was God's idea about how to take care of Sisera?
No.
No? What do you think God wanted them to do?
Convert them.
Well, that would have been nice, huh? Well, if you read some of these passages, Judges 4, 7, and 5, 4, and 5, and verse 21, it turns out that Sisera showed up with his iron chariots. Now, they weren't all iron. They wouldn't have been able to pull them. They'd been way too heavy. But apparently iron fortified chariots. And what does God do? They're trying to charge through the dirt roads with these heavy chariots. God sends a bunch of rain. And guess what's happening with the chariots? They're bogging down in the mud.
Are you intimating here with this story of Deborah and Sisera that there are stories in the Bible that are not they're stories of victory, but they're not necessarily examples of what we should do. Mm-hmm. So just because it's in the Bible doesn't necessarily mean, and these are heroes, doesn't necessarily mean we should attack the problem in the same manner.
No.
So how do we tell the difference?
We give stories to our children, don't we?
How do we tell the difference? I mean, that sounds like a good idea, a good way to solve that.
David was a hero when he threw a rock and killed Goliath and cut off his head, right?
Right.
You'd love to tell that story to your kids, right?
Well, we don't go to the cutting the head off part. We just throw the rock.
That's vicious enough, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, why do you think the Israelites put their trust in Deborah? Because she was good looking, because of her personality, her force of character, her righteous judgments? Or do they really think God was directing her? And we're talking about a great controversy here. Mm-hmm. What do you think?
Hopefully it was because they thought that God was directing her. But I'm not sure it was that deep.
Mm-hmm. Well, many years after the story of Deborah, the Midianites, the Amalekites, and the desert tribesmen began to oppress the Israelites, coming up from the southeast. Now, Jabin came from the north. He was way up in the north part of Canaan. What we later came to be called Galilee. And he attacked the Israelites from the north. Now, coming up from the southeast, we have these Midianites, Amalekites, etc., and the desert tribes. And what were they doing? They were sending these little warring groups. They'd charge into Israel there, and they would just take whatever they felt like taking or destroy it. So the poor Israelites were, you know. And why was this happening to them? Do we need to reiterate why this was happening to them? They had turned away from God again, hadn't they?
Let me, you know, we're moving through this so fast, by the time I come up with an answer to a question, while we're down two or three other stories.
I'm sorry.
Well, no, that's fine. This situation with Deborah and these people we've been talking about here, maybe God has to use what he has available.
Exactly.
And it may not be perfect, but they're perfect in their commitment to the Lord.
I hope
maybe
so.
Not in the way that they go about solving some of their problems. And God honors that commitment, even though he would prefer maybe that they might solve some problems some other ways. But, you know, this is the treasures that they bring, and he uses it as best he can.
Okay. So let's go to our next story, and I think we can illustrate your point even better. God sends an angel down to talk to Gideon. What's Gideon doing?
Hiding.
He's threshing some wheat in a wine press, hoping no one will be looking in the wine press because it's not the time to press grapes. Okay? He's hiding. And what does the angel say to him? The Lord is with you, brave and mighty man. Mm-hmm. And Gideon says, who are you talking to? You know, You could just see him. I really enjoy these Bible stories. Some of them are just... You think he was trying to be sarcastic? Well, how could God command him? What he said next is, go with all your great strength and rescue Israel from the Midianites. I myself am sending you. He hasn't even promised to go with him yet. Is he trying to impress Gideon with his power? What was Gideon's response? I'm just from the tribe of Manasseh, and I'm the weakest part of the weakest tribe. Why are you asking me?
Well, perhaps Gideon was brave in that he was still seeking to accomplish what should be accomplished in behalf of Israel, whereas everybody else wasn't doing anything.
Yeah.
And he, even in his courage, he had hidden himself here.
Do we know anything about what was happening in Gideon's family?
They were worshiping the Baals.
His father had a worship site for Baal and Ashtoreth on his property. And people came there to worship Baal and Ashtoreth on the property of Gideon's family. So what did Gideon do? God says, go and destroy those idols. So Gideon went up there in the middle of the day and did it, right? No, he was too embarrassed to do it. He was afraid. So he went up there to destroy his own family's idols in the middle of the night. And what happened next? Remember the story? Everybody came up, where's our idols? What happened? And Gideon's father, he obviously knew what had happened. He was the owner of these idols. He says, who are you trying to defend here? If these idols amounted to anything, of Baal and Ashtoreth amounted to anything, shouldn't they be able to defend themselves? Again, I have to chuckle. Shouldn't these gods be able to defend themselves? Then he sent the people home. Anyway, that's not the usual part of the story that we talk about.
Mm-hmm. He was easily changed from being the supporter of these idols to maybe he saw the light.
Yeah. So what did it take to convince Gideon to go out and fight? Which he didn't really basically have to fight at all. But what
took
did
a personal
take?
Message from God and a lot of
twice,
miracles.
And a lot of miracles. Can you mention some?
The fleece being his
first of all
patch of cloth, fleece being being wet when soaked. Everything else is dry, and then being dry when everything else was wet. And,
can you imagine, again, we're talking about the great controversy here, the people standing around the throne of God saying, what are you doing now, God? Well, I have to help Gideon out a little bit down there.
I have to convince him that I'm really God. I'm not, yeah. I'm not a, you know, some non-God.
Incredible. So then Gideon sends out a message to one small part of the people of Israel, not only 2-3 tribes, says, come and help me. We're going to go fight against the Midianites. 32,000 men show up. And what happens?
Well, that sounds like a pretty nice representation.
Yeah,
we've got some pretty righteous people showing up to do what the Lord wants
the
done.
The just cause.
Yeah. There were at least three times that many Midianites to fight against. If that gives you any idea.
32,000 Israelites showed up. That's a pretty good turnout.
Yeah. And God said to Gideon, tell these men, if any of you are afraid that something might happen to you, go home. How many left?
Most, 2/3 of them.
22,000 went home. So now he has 10,000 left. And God says, you still have what?
Too many.
Too many. Yeah, still have too many. So what happens? They devise this little test about how if you just scoop up some water from the river and drink like this, you're part of the group. Otherwise, if you stop and to get a drink, you're out. And he ends up with how many?
300.
Now, out if 300...
32,000.
What?
Out of 32,000.
Out of 32,000.
Against an enemy of...
100,000 or more. Okay? Now, who is going to win this battle? The 300 people?
God's going to win it.
There's no question about who's in charge here, right?
If they'd gone with 32,000 against 100,000 enemies, the Israelites might have thought that they had won.
Exactly.
Even the 10,000, they might have thought that they had won. Mm-hmm. But now you get it down to 300, and the answer is obvious who's fighting the battle.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So out of this army of 120,000, Scripture suggests, there were only 15,000 left. Remember, they went up that night.
The enemy.
They blew their trumpets. They broke the pitchers so they could show the lights, the lamps, that the firebrands they were holding. And what happened? The people out there, the Midianites and the Amalekites, came out of their tent. Whoa, what's going on? And they started fighting each other. And when it was all done, they had killed the two of the Midianite kings and a bunch of the Midianite chiefs, and there were only 15,000 of the military. Midianite military left.
Now, the torch traditionally meant that it was a leader of 100 or something like, or 200 men or something like that.
And they were coming from all sides, three different sides, and all of a sudden it looked like three huge armies were attacking them. Yeah. Well, then there's the story of Samson.
So, what did we learn from the story of Gideon?
What did we learn from the story of Gideon? Several things. One, God can work with few or with many. He takes care of things if we're on his side. Okay. Two, God will reach us where we are. I mean, Gideon seemed like the most unlikeliest of champions. Of course, I will have to say that the rest of the story of Gideon, he ends up with multiple wives, he ends up with concubines, he ends up having some of his own gods there and so forth. So Gideon isn't a perfect example. But God still worked with him. So I think it's a case of God reaching down and trying to work with people who are just about as far away from him as they could get.
Why did he work so valiantly with Gideon, and yet someone like Stephen in the New Testament, he didn't come out so well?
No. Well, he did his job. Stephen did his
well,
job.
Well, yeah, but he didn't come out. He ended up dead. So how come some of these people are...
You know how many million more have ended up like Stephen?
Well, lots. So the question is, why don't they all end up like Gideon? Or why don't they all end up like Deborah? Or
if God came down and interfered every time one of his people got in any kind of trouble, pretty soon what would happen? People would want to be Christians for the wrong reasons.
Rice Christians.
Have you ever heard of that term before?
As with all the failings of Samson in his life, yet he's in Hebrews 11.
Yep.
Now, what does that tell us about God?
Wow.
Isn't God far more gracious than most people give him credit for?
Yeah, well, we know, just very briefly reviewing the story of Samson, his parents were, an angel appeared to his parents, said, don't cut his hair. Mama's not supposed to drink any wine or any alcohol. He's not supposed to drink any wine or alcohol. He's going to be my representative. So God spent at least 20 years waiting for this guy to grow up. But just as, and now I'm going to quote from Ellen White, Patriarchs and Prophets, page 563, just as he was entering upon manhood, the time when he must execute his divine mission, the time above all others when he should have been true to God, Samson connected himself with the enemies of Israel. What did he do?
Well, he liked girlfriends over there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He did not ask whether he could get better glorify God when united with the object of his choice, or whether he was placing himself in a position where he could not fulfill the purpose to be accomplished by his life. To all who seek first to honor him, God has promised wisdom, but there is no promise to those who are bent upon self-pleasing. Wow. So what do we... We don't have time to talk about all of Samson's exploits. Let me just read a summary very quickly. Samson moved against the Philistines in a number of ways. First, he killed 30 men and took their clothes back to his wedding feast to pay a debt, Judges 14:19. Then he destroyed their crops when his wife was given to his best man, Judges 14:20 and 15:1-5. Then Samson killed many in revenge for the Philistines killing his wife and her father, Judges 15:6-8. When the Philistines tried to avenge their action, Judges 15:9 and 10, he killed 1,000 with a donkey's jawbone. And I remember, this is Judges 15:14 and 15. I remember some friends back when I was in college said, if we did that much with a jawbone, think of what he could have done with a little backbone. Finally, he pulled down their temple and killed 3,000 for blinding him, Judges 16:21, 28, and 30. But incredible as it may seem, despite all his flaws and foibles, Samson ended up at the faith chapter, as Jim has already mentioned. There he is with Rahab, Jephthah, and David. Think about their foibles. But he's along with Abraham and Sarah and Moses. What a chapter, right? And then there's the story of Ruth. What do we know about Ruth?
Well, it's one of the greatest love stories in the Bible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There was a famine in the land, and is it Naomi?
Naomi, yes.
And her.
Her husband Elimelech.
That's right. They had to leave. They had to leave the land because of the famine and go down where there was.
Let's talk about that. Bethlehem is on a high spot, overlooking the Jordan Valley, right across the valley, which is easy to see across. There is Moab. So this is a case of the grass is greener on the other side of the valley.
So, well, I was always under the impression there was a famine, but what you're saying is, well, no, there's more, the living is better over there, yeah. The economy is better over there.
That's what it looked like. So what did they do?
They moved over there in a place that they weren't supposed to be.
Okay, and what happened?
Well, both husbands died.
Well, Naomi's husband died, and then both of her sons died.
That's right.
So here's this woman. Who's a widow?
After they'd gotten married and
had three widowers. Three widowers, right? Three of them. Now, there's several interesting things about this story that we usually don't talk about. Did Naomi have any other children?
Not stated.
Did Ruth have any children by her first husband?
Apparently not.
No, none that we know about. Did Orpah have any children by her first husband?
Apparently not.
No mention, if that was the case.
What's going on here? Somebody practicing birth control or what?
It has to do with the famine, lack of proper nutrition.
Well, but when they went over to Moab, it probably wasn't that bad, at least at first. So we know that
To answer that question, certainly God could practice birth control for them.
We know the Bible says at different times that he had
in Egypt,
yeah, and Gezer. While Orpah at the urging of Naomi returned her, so Naomi's getting ready to go back home. And why do you think she decided to go back home? Just because that was home, or was there another reason why she might have decided to go back home?
Well, I think the story intimates that things get better. Mm-hmm. The famine abates, so that makes some sense. She's also a Jewish woman over in Moab, and just as the Jews look kind of unfavorably on the Moabites look kind of unfavorably on her, and here she is, a widower now, and in those days, widowers were in bad straits even in their own country.
Just about the bottom of the pile, But there's another reason.
She had some land back home, or her husband had some land back home.
And how did that happen?
Well, he's of the tribe.
Yeah. She had no property in Moab that she was rightfully, but in Judah, what was hers?
What her husband had.
Well, remember that according to the Jewish system, every 7 years, even if you sell your property, what happens?
Jubilee.
Well, not Jubilee is every 50 years. But every 7 years, the property has to be returned to the family of the original owner. So I suspect it was probably one of those years was coming up, and Naomi says, well, back there, at least I have something. So she went back to, and she may have, we don't know how long she was in Moab, she may have been there 14, 21 years, but I think that she probably recognized that there's a possibility she could go back and at least claim the land and maybe she would get something out of it. So she says, I'm headed home. And who started out with her?
Both daughter-in-laws.
Both daughter-in-laws. And then Orpah, Naomi says, ladies, let's be honest. I'm not going to have any more sons. So I can't, there's no way. And even if I could, you're not going to wait 25 years or how many years for them to grow up to be your husbands. So Orpah finally said, okay, I'm going to go back. And what did Ruth say?
Stay with you.
Famous words, huh? Entreat me not to leave thee, that we sing at weddings. This is not a husband to his wife or a wife to her husband. These are the words of a daughter-in-law to her mother-in-law. Right? Incredible. Mm-hmm. Well, when Ruth arrived over there in Bethlehem, what happened to her?
Gleaning on the fields of Boaz.
She apparently was recognized for several things. The story implies he probably was pretty good looking, for one thing. She was industrious. Everybody recognized her as a newcomer to the community. They recognized that Naomi was in trouble because of what had happened to her. And so here's this good-looking young foreign woman.
Moabitess.
Moabitess, yes. Well, she goes out to glean something from the corners of the fields.
Which was part of the economic system by which they took care of people who were somewhat impoverished.
And
when they went through to glean, there was always some left over, and they were to leave, not pick the field entirely glean, to leave those for others to come by.
Okay. And what happened to her when she was out there?
She was noticed.
She was noticed is right. She was noticed. And what did Boaz say?
Leave some extra.
Leave some extra. Not only that, but he said to her, don't go anywhere else because you could be attacked. And that's why I say, obviously, she's not unattractive, at least, put it that way, okay?
Well, do you think he was attracted? His concern for her was that she was attractive, or that he knew of the familial connection with
Naomi?
With Naomi and
probably some
or
of
that
all.
He just knew his neighbors, that they would do bad things to people. But here's this Israelite that's now being friendly with a Moabite.
Is that
Moabite
a good thing?
Woman, well, that's not supposed to happen.
Shall I read to you what it says about what's supposed to happen with Moabites?
Maybe you better
go to Genesis 24.
And who's giving these instructions?
Well, they're in Genesis. Who would you say?
Moses is giving these
instructions? I'm sorry. It's not Genesis 24. It's Deuteronomy 24. I have to stop and think about this for a second.
Not very nice of Moses to give these kinds of instructions.
Okay. It's somewhere here. Anyway,
basically says that you can't do this. It's a curse.
He said, if you are married to a Moabite or an Ammonite, you are not supposed to be a part of God's people for 10 generations. How does that sound?
And yet,
yet what?
This is the family that becomes David. Three generations.
And who's Boaz? Where does Boaz come from?
From Rahab.
Rahab, the prostitute from Jericho, who is preserved by a miracle, marries one of the leading men of Judah, and has a son, and that son's name is Boaz. Well, did Boaz immediately take over and say, yes, I'll just welcome you into my harem? What happened?
Now, he knew that there was a closer relative, so he had to have some negotiation with his closer relative of Naomi to say, yeah, you can take over this loan, basically.
Well, and when Ruth began to bring all this extra loot that was left behind by Boaz's men under Boaz's instructions, Ruth began to bring this home. Naomi saw something is not normal here.
Well, something is very good here, right?
Well, that's true, but it's unusual that.
So, what did she tell Ruth to do?
A weird thing.
Weird thing?
Go to where Boaz is sleeping and to.
Why is Boaz sleeping out there in the field?
Well, he's working.
Well, he's working late, probably, but that's not the only reason. What do you suppose happens if you got a huge crop out there in the field and you just leave it overnight?
Somebody's going to get some.
People who live in that part of the world, they'd have come in the morning and the harvest would be gone.
Right.
So he's out there protecting his crop. Okay, and what happens?
Well,
Naomi says to Ruth,
go out there and lay down at his feet.
Okay.
Which is kind of a funny thing to do.
Yes, and then what happens next?
He takes a notion to her for her.
Yeah, he rolls over in the middle of the night and bumps into her. Who are you? Oh, it's you. Okay.
Yeah, wasn't this? Was there some kind of a custom involved here?
Something. And what did Ruth say to him? Marry me. Who's proposing who here? Was that a custom? Was that the ordinary way things were done in those days?
No. Well, that's unusual. A Moabite would.
No. Well, of course, we know that they married. They had a son by the name of Obed, whose son was Jesse, whose son was
David.
King David. Wow. Well, near the end of the time of the judges, there was Samuel. What do we know about Samuel?
So does that mean we're supposed to kind of ignore those rules in Deuteronomy about not to have anything to do with the Moabites?
You weren't supposed to ask that.
Well,
in general, that was the right thing to do.
Ignore the rules in Deuteronomy?
No, to follow the rules in Deuteronomy, but occasionally there were times when you could ignore them.
I see. I kind of like that idea, being able to pick and choose the rules.
Well, I think God is the one who does the picking and choosing and not us.
Well, how did Naomi know that it was okay to ignore those rules?
Well, we need to talk about Samuel. What do we know about the story about Samuel?
He had a habit of picking rules that he was going to comply with. And the ones that he wasn't.
First of all, he was a miracle son too.
Yes.
From a woman, his mother, Hannah, couldn't have children. Then all of a sudden she has Samuel, and Hannah, for some strange reason, turns him over at a very young age to Eli, who has a terrible time raising children.
Yes. You know, we need to recognize she was desperate for a child.
Well, I'm sorry, I thought you were talking about Samson here. I apologize.
No, Samuel. So he's desperate. She's desperate because Peninnah, her rival, her second wife, was having children right and left. And she says, you know, they would go down to the tabernacle to offer sacrifices, and of course he would have to give sacrifices on behalf of Peninnah and all her children, and he would give Hannah a double portion, but even so, it was not the same. Anyway, I won't go into all the details here, but finally, she goes to the, when they're down there at Ramah, she goes to Shiloh, I'm sorry, they came from Ramah, went to Shiloh. She went up to the gate, to the door of the tabernacle, and she was praying fervently. And Eli came along, and what did he say?
You're drunk.
Why are you drunk? And he, oh, no, not me. I don't drink, but I'm praying. He says, whatever you're praying for, God bless you. And what happened?
She was praying for came true.
What she was praying for.
A little boy.
Eli was priest, and now I'm going to read some comments from Ellen White.
And in her prayer, she promised to dedicate him to.
Yes.
If you give him to me, I will dedicate him to you.
Patriarchs and Prophets, page 575. Eli was priest and judge in Israel. He held the highest and most responsible positions among the people of God. As a man divinely chosen for the sacred duties of the priesthood and set over the land as the highest judicial authority, he was looked up to as an example, and he wielded a great influence over the tribes of Israel. But although he had been appointed to govern the people, he did not rule his own household. Eli was an indulgent father. Loving peace and ease, he did not exercise his authority to correct the evil habits and passions of his children. Rather than contend with them or punish them, he would submit to their will and give them their own way. Instead of regarding the education of his sons as one of the most important of his responsibilities, he treated the matter as of little consequence. The priest and judge of Israel had not been left in darkness as to the duty of restraining and governing the children that God had given to his care. But Eli shrank from his duty because it involved crossing the will of his sons and wouldn't make it necessary to punish and deny them. Without weighing the terrible consequences that would follow his course, he indulged his children in whatever they desired and neglected the work of fitting them for the service of God and the duties of life. Patriarchs and Prophets 575. And what did they do?
Well, took bribes.
Whatever they wanted, pretty much.
They were abusing the women who came to offer sacrifices at the temple. And not just beating on them, sleeping with them.
They were drunk.
And they were drunk. A little while later, what happened? There was war with the Philistines. And what did they do?
Took the ark out. That was a good luck charm.
The people insisted that they take the ark.
They said, get the ark out here. We want to force God to fight for us. That's basically what they were trying to do, force God to fight for them. And what happened?
They lost their lucky rabbit's foot.
They lost the ark. They were, both of them died. What happened when Eli heard about it? He was 98.
Fell over, broke his neck, and died.
He fell over backwards off of his chair, broke his neck, and died. So all of a sudden, who's left in charge of the temple?
Samuel.
Young Samuel. Unfortunately, Samuel didn't do much better at controlling his children. But he did something else. He did a couple things we need to talk about. What did Samuel accomplish? Remember?
Schools of the prophets.
He built the schools of the prophets, the first schools of the prophets. What was the purpose of the schools of the prophets? Do you remember? These were supposed
education.
To teach, educate the spiritual and religious and moral and military or civil leaders of Israel. So he was taking this seriously.
The amazing thing is that God hadn't instructed them to do that earlier.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, when Samuel was getting old and his sons were taking bribes and mishandling justice and so forth, what did the people come and say to Samuel?
Give us a king.
Give us a king.
We want to be like the others.
We want to be like other nations. Do you think they would have said that if Samuel's sons had been behaving themselves?
Probably not.
Maybe not for another generation or two.
Yeah. Wow.
That's probably even too optimistic.
Yeah.
Is that because Samuel wasn't doing a very good job as a judge?
Well, he was doing good. People really appreciated him. They thought he was doing great. What he wasn't doing a good job was being a father.
Mm.
His sons were taking bribes and abusing people.
There was something else motivating this desire for a king.
Yeah. Well, Samuel was given the challenge, first of all, of anointing Saul. And why was Saul chosen?
He was tall and handsome.
He was the kind of person they wanted, the people wanted for a king. And he turned out to be rotten, as we know.
Has human nature been much different down through the ages?
No.
I mean.
Yeah.
It's interesting, the story of Saul begins like it ends. He's out looking for donkeys and he can't find them, so he goes and looks for a witch to help him solve that problem. And then later on, the end of the story is exactly the same.
As the witch to bring up Samuel.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, one of the obvious facts that we should learn from these stories, when we talk about, okay, what have we learned? Clearly, we have learned that God's love prevents him from forcing people to do his will. If you make a choice to go the other direction, God will allow you, very clearly. It's very clear also that God doesn't gloss over the sins of his Bible, even the ones we might call heroes. Samuel's sons were called the sons of Belial. What's Belial? Belial is a word which means useless or worthless and is sometimes used to describe Satan himself.
It looks like tragedy. Looks like God is losing again.
I'm sorry, this was the sons of Eli. Did I say the sons of Samuel? Yeah, it looks like God's losing again. What a tragedy these sons of these two great men proved to be. God does not stand toward the sinner. Reading from Great Controversy now, page 36 in Spirit of Prophecy, volume 4, page 36. God does not stand toward the sinner as an executioner of the sentence against transgressions. But he leaves the rejecters of his mercy to themselves to reap that which they have sown. In the Great Controversy, every individual must make up his own mind. We are either on God's side or on Satan's side. We cannot remain as fence sitters. If we had time to review the whole book of Judges, we would learn other things. But don't forget that cycle: apostasy, oppression, cries for help, and divine intervention, and what it teaches us about God and his wrath. Our loving Father, once again, we are so thankful for these words of Scripture that teach us so plainly about the kind of person you are. Forgive us, for we have made mistakes similar to those of ancient times. Help us to stand firm as we approach another perilous time ahead of us. As the world becomes more and more wicked, may we stand up as bright lights for you, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.